Also, Valero was one of the companies that we viewed as, well, cheap according to our model. And from the upstream companies, we also have a few more. However, the upstream segment has been struggling recently, so we didn't feel too comfortable pitching on our company. As far as the midstream segment goes, we didn't have any midstream companies on our portfolio. And even after researching it, we just weren't sure how to value midstream companies properly. So we just decided to, you know, abandon the idea right there. And then also the other thing about midstream companies is that now with the Keystone Pipeline, whenever we started our ranking model, there was still a catalyst that could have a huge effect on how those companies will operate in the future, basically, right? So we just didn't feel comfortable with doing it. And as far as their hedging goes, so here they increased their spending on derivatives and hedging.
2014.
Yeah, 2014. So they went from 1 million to 710.
Yeah.
And so just to show you how that affected stock price when compared to oil prices. So, and as I said, they had a really, really strong correlation with the WTI. However, over here, whenever oil prices just fell, yes, the company's stock price was affected, but the slope wasn't as steep as oil prices. So, which I believe was due to their hedging strategies, so I think that should continue in the future as well.
You had a bunch of names that, are either currently owned or I think you're evaluating. And,
yes, sir.
And your model has, you're saying your model has informed recommended changes to the current holdings? Is that what I got from that one slide?
No.
I thought it said reduce and increase.
Oh, he's talking about
No. So over here, what I was saying. So we took the top seven companies as they were very close to each other, and we just re-ranked them.
Oh,
we were looking at how the market values them versus how we value them.
I see.
Yes, sir.
If you go up to the current holdings, so then, yeah, there you go. So what are your recommendations to that based on your work here?
Yeah, so as far as Apache goes, it was actually ranked, I believe, as, and let me just double check to make sure, yeah, they were ranked as the number one company based on our valuation. And as we did, what we did is we split up the work. We had all of these companies and read equity research reports and just what the consensus was on them. We didn't have time to do a full-blown analysis on each and every single one of them. But we trusted our model and we trusted equity research reports. And as far as Cimarex goes, great company, was hired highly.
Yeah, ranked about five.
Here as well. And the rest of them. So Marathon is one of those companies that we believe is going to make strong ties within the downstream sector. They have good operations. They have been voicing how they believe they are undervalued and they can do better. Now that puts some pressure on them. I know a few activist investors came in, and because of that now there's even more pressure increase, of course. And refiners as a whole, they've been doing great even in softer margin environments because they learned how to optimize their operations. So we are not worried about the refining margins being volatile.
Last year,
2015 compared to our first quarter of 2015 compared to now. But even then, all these companies are good enough to generate decent returns. And as far as Oxy goes, so Oxy was ranked as number one. In our model.
Okay, so generally you're saying that they all scored relatively well.
Exactly. And the only company that didn't really score too well, and we have some concerns about it, as crazy as it sounds, is Exxon. So they are getting into just tremendous amounts of lawsuits, so they have that exposure right there, which, you know, after Rex Tillerson leaving, there might be a problem now that they have to reorganize and find new senior management, as well as for the past year they lost, I believe, about 6% of the, or their stock price dropped about 6%, and I just don't believe that it's time for us to hold Exxon, even though they're a great company, great revenue, but if their stock prices keep on decreasing, then there must be something in the water, you know?
You tend to own more than, more individual names than some of the other sectors that I've seen. Do you tend to own smaller weights? Is that the idea that you sort of spread it out, or how does that work?
Yes, so we spread out weights based on market cap, so we don't want to put in too much money into a small cap company. While, you know, companies with great credit rating, reliable companies, you might want to overweight them, and that's how we believe that our part of the portfolio should be too, yes.
And I forgot to tell you, there are actually three sectors. Energy, we break it into three, whereas consumer staples is only one sector. So that's part of the reason too. We have more in energy than we do in consumer staples.
So on your, we're almost out of time, but real quick, your multiples, you kind of talked about multiple expansion.
Yeah.
And I noticed then you did your sensitivity analysis on your multiple expansion. Did you kind of maybe run the base case with no expansion at all? I think you said it went from 7.2 to 7.4,
yeah,
something like that.
So
I see the 7, and I guess that's close to 7.2, I don't know if that's just because it's equal, you know, 50 basis point increments.
Yeah.
But maybe have a no expansion, no contract, you know, compression of multiples as kind of to see what happens when there's no change in the multiples.
Yeah, exactly. So actually this, or these sensitivity analyses just assumed 7 as their as a current,
the base case, current,
yeah,
okay,
as a current assigned EBITDA multiple. And so you see with 7.5, their enterprise value would go up significantly, and it would have about, yeah, well, almost $4 effect on the stock price.
$3.50. And I guess, I don't know what the current price is.
Current price is $32.
So you still, even with no expansion, with no multiple expansion, you still think it would get a positive buy? Given that it's 38, I'm looking at that one. So it still would have some upside potential.
Yes.
But with no expansion.
I believe so. And the reason why is because they are very dependent on commodity prices, as we said. So even if commodity prices don't change and they go up to $39, that's a solid, still solid 20% return.
Did you do a sensitivity analysis with the price of oil? I see you got the multiples in the...
No, we did not. That would have been very complicated for us.
Okay. And then just the last real quick one. I like that you kind of thought about your downside risk and had a protective put. You know, did you analyze and go, what's the cost of that? Did you try to kind of go, and I get that you said how much it was, you know, per contract for an out-of-the-money put. But you have to roll that over, and you were kind of doing a one-year analysis. Mm-hmm. You kind of go over that 1 year, and how much of it are we going to cover? Are we going to do a partial risk? You know, are we going to cover the entire thing, or are we going to just kind of do a partial hedge?
So what we thought was we should we should use a protected put strategy until August. The reason why is because OPEC is about to meet in May. Summer driving season is coming up. There are a lot of geopolitical risks, which we don't know how it's going to pan out. Now, if whatever happens to the price of oil, there's a much more downside to it, and we would much rather manage our risk than look at the upside. And yet, granted, we could make about 55 cents more, but I just believe that protecting the downside is more valuable.